Bombing of the 16th Street Baptist Church in Birmingham, Alabama. Instead of being heralded for his commitment to civil rights and peaceful protest in the face of racial violence, Attorney General Robert Kennedy authorized the FBI's wiretap of his home. And though it guiled many, for the second time in his life, King was named Time Magazine's Man of the Year. Thereafter, King was besieged with requests to support various civil rights struggles across the nation. He met with several local and state leaders, and this included one meeting with Malcolm X in Washington, D.C. in 1964. And as quiet as it is kept, King was not anti-black power. He understood the movement and critiqued it socially and intellectually. Still, he was attacked and vilified as a communist by FBI Director J. Edgar Hoover. Yet, at the end of 1964, he received the Nobel Peace Prize in Oslo, Norway. At this time, King was 35 years old. He was the youngest person ever to receive the Nobel Prize. And he vowed to use the $54,000 prize towards the aims of the civil rights movement. The next year, in 1965, King, James Forman, and our own John Lewis, in the aftermath of Bloody Sunday, marched from Selma to Montgomery. Thereafter, we have another important marker in King's activism, when, with faith and courage, he publicly denounced the Vietnam War. In 1967, King delivered another speech entitled Beyond Vietnam in New York City. He also published Where Do We Go From Here? Chaos or Community, in which the Vietnam War is one of several important issues he addressed. Dr. King continued to organize, to lead, and to participate in peaceful protests, including the demonstration of thousands of black sanitation workers who went out on strike in Memphis, Tennessee. When this protest experienced violence and chaos, King was determined to return and execute a peaceful march there. In the process of doing so in Memphis, Tennessee, on April 3, 1968, Dr. King delivered his I've Been to the Mountaintop speech. In the final speech of his life, Dr. King stated poignantly, "Like anybody, I would like to live a long life. Longevity has its place. But I'm not concerned about that now. I just want to do God's will. And so I'm happy tonight. I'm not worried about anything. I'm not fearing any man. Mine eyes have seen the glory of the coming of the Lord." The next morning, on April 4th, 1968, Dr. King was assassinated as he stood on the balcony of the Lorraine Motel in Memphis, Tennessee, and he was buried in Atlanta a week later. Dr. King was a true witness to history, and his life and legacy is a testament to our contemporary quest for freedom. He was continually threatened, constantly bombed. Twice his home was bombed. He was physically attacked and surveilled and harassed by government agencies. Every intimate chapter of his life was officially scrutinized, and all of his flaws, real and imagined, were brought to the forefront. He was called cruel names, subjected to harassment and arrest. Some say he was arrested more than 30 times. And his speeches and his writings were dismissed and criticized. And yet, with his unwavering faith in God and his courage, he spoke truth to power. He stood with the people. He was committed to the nonviolent, peaceful way of life. He was a man of faith who loved God. He was incredibly well-read. He thought deeply about the purpose of life. And at times, he even predicted the future. And I've often wondered, what manner of man was this? And I say, he was a resplendent being. Now, by definition, the term resplendent means to shine, to be brilliant. In my further conceptualization of the term for an unpublished paper written many years ago, a resplendent being is a person who shines because they know history, and they know when they are making history, living in history, and they act accordingly. They are resplendent for many reasons. But for King, it was not only because he knew he was living in history. He knew that his thoughts and actions in the prevailing racial climate would make him a martyr, and he was willing to make the sacrifice. So as we stand in the light of Dr. King's resplendent legacy, his words to us echo through time and space. We now seem to live in what poet and performance artist Sekou Sundiata called the long reign of the upside down, where, like in George Orwell's Newspeak and Doublethink, up is down and black is white and 2 + 2 = 5, and today in our strange fruit reality, black lives don't matter, but all lives matter. We live in a world where doing the right thing is shunned, but doing what is expedient and profitable, no matter how callous and inhumane, is admired. Let me tell you, I don't often say much, but I want you to know that I know. We live in a world where kindness is laughed at, but crime is sensationalized. We speak to one another in deceptively shielded and coded language, if we speak at all. And those who can't decipher the codes are treated like pawns and fools in this world. We are told that this world belongs to those who possess great power and authority. But I say, we can't give up on King's philosophy. We can't give up on his vision. We can't give up on the idea of peace. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called the children of God. In this world, we have a very short memory, don't we? Who needs history? Yesterday's sexual predator is today's statesman. In this world, some people think you can be too intelligent. We live in a world where celebrity is prized over logic and reason, intellect, fact, and even good behavior. In this world, history, well, history, like truth, is no longer necessary. A world where seemingly anything can be monetized. A world where humanity is to be managed to benefit the few. But Dr. King had what African Americans used to call soul force. He had soul force. Yet he knew about difficult days ahead, did he not? Well, we have got some difficult days ahead. All of us. So my question is, are we going to stand together, or will it be every man for himself? Will Dr. King's expansive life be a rich resource for us, or merely a momentary reference? Dr. King had a choice, and he stood with the people. We don't have to accept the so-called new normal, because there is nothing new or normal about attempting to get the masses of people to accept false equivalencies. We don't have to accept racial and gender double standards. We don't have to accept mediocrity over excellence, exploitation over fairness and generosity, and austerity over plenty. But like Dr. King, I want to tell you, I am not discouraged about the future. He noted in one of his sermons, Pilgrimage to Nonviolence in 1960, he said, In spite of the tensions and uncertainties of this period, something profoundly meaningful is taking place. Old systems of exploitation and oppression are passing away. New systems of justice and equality are being born. In a real sense, this is a great time to be alive. So yes, we are excited about this new time. We are excited about new technologies. We are embarking on autonomous vehicles, the self-driving cars. Everyone has a computer in their pocket. We've got wearable technology now. Robots clean our floors. And we're exploring and developing the Internet of Things. And we also have some dynamic challenges as well. We've got fake news, hyper-partisanism, and of course that's related to our social media bubbles. So we've got a lot to be concerned about, but we also have a lot to be buoyed about. This is not George Orwell's dark and bleak 1984. But you know, it could be. Will we allow our leaders to be attacked? Our youth, our elders, our colleagues, our friends? When the thought police come, will we inform on our neighbors and coworkers? Will we sit silently and say nothing as long as the long rain of the upside down burrows into our psyche? Will we forget how to build organizations and institutions? I know you don't want to hear it, but history is calling all of us in the here and the now. You know, President Obama has made the pledge in his farewell address last week, and he spoke of decency among people. He spoke about common purpose and solidarity among people. And he talked about opportunity and equal treatment. And most of all, he talked about the responsibility of citizens to guard democracy. So like the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., my message to you is to use your life to be a beacon of hope to someone, to the people. Be energized, be inspired. Write, speak, think, organize, smile, protest, march, pray, have hope. Help somebody whenever you can. And instead of waiting for a thank you, just move on to the next mission, moment, or movement. And brothers and sisters, most of all, have faith and courage. Thank you very much. Gracias, mi amor. Sobrevivimos.